All right, dude, it's recording right now. So let us. I want to hear you school these idiotic 9/11 truthers, my friend.
So this is the way this works. So many people, and every time you try to explain it to people, they don't want to fucking hear it, which only tells me that 9/11 truthers are not really truthers in a sense. They actually want 9/11 to be an inside job. They actually wish that was the case. So they try to make that the case in the first place. Maybe that's because they've invested so much time in believing it. Nobody wants to admit that they're wrong or retarded or whatever, right?
Yep.
Well, anyway, every time you see somebody say something, they always say something like, "A plane's not taking down a building," or "Jet fuel doesn't melt steel beams." Well, A, jet fuel does not melt steel beams. That is true. Jet fuel can, in fact, when lit on fire and burning, weaken steel beams. There's a video I just posted on my Facebook, and I'm going to send it to you, Nick, if you want to show this to anybody.
Okay.
It's a video, it's a clip from an actual 9/11 investigative report that I saw where they actually found a bunch of evidence. Now, nonetheless, okay, what people don't seem to understand is that when the planes hit the building, the building did not just sustain one point of damage. The building sustained 4 points of damage. Point of damage number one is you have this massive, these were not small planes. These are giant. These are like most people who fly across the country are not even flying in planes this big. These are these giant planes that have two stories in them and shit like that. These fucking planes are huge and they weigh massive amounts of weight, tons. They weigh many tons. Okay? So you have this thing, this giant metal flying thing, flying at, I want to say what, it was over 500 miles per hour or something, slamming into a building. Now that's a massive fucking hit, number one. Okay, that's huge. There was an incident we had to learn about when I went to traffic school one time where this guy was running from the police on a crotch rocket and he reached a speed of like 260. Now that's really fucking fast for a land vehicle, right? And he reached a speed on a freeway of like 260 or on a highway, and this guy was pulling out in a truck. And so he looks and he sees there's a light coming, but it's way far. He doesn't, you can't really, you don't realize when you're looking at a light coming towards you how fast it's coming towards you. So he's like, okay, so there's that vehicle. So he goes to turn out, and that light goes from point A to him in a couple seconds because he's going, because the motorcycle is going so fast, and T-bones this truck. This truck flies into the air and flips, like, and it spins, I don't know how many times, it's like 20 some times, and boom, lands. Both the driver of the truck and the driver of the motorcycle were killed instantly. Many parts of their body were liquefied by the impact. Not only that, there were in fact pieces of the motorcycle and pieces of the fucking engine of the truck fused together. They were fused. They fused into each other because of such an impact, right? So you have that. So a giant plane going over 500 miles per hour with that much weight behind it is gonna do amazing amounts of damage. Not only that, so that's damage number one, and you have multiple floors being damaged all at once because this plane is huge. You know what I mean? It's not one fucking floor; it's multiple floors. So you have that happening. So that's damage point number one. Damage point number two: when it gets into the building, it blows up. That's an explosion in a very tight-knit inside environment. So there's a lot more pressure with a big explosion like this. That's damage point number two. You are now taking out even more steel beams, and you are damaging even more. So that's where that happens. Number three is all these beams that are not damaged at all, whatever beams are left around the area that are not damaged, or in some that are damaged, now they have tons. How many stories above the impact point were left intact? Tons of weight redistributed for these beams to support. When you have some that weighs so many pounds and you have support beams under it, anything that supports it, if you remove one of them, the weight has to be redistributed to all the other ones. Therefore, you have, and I don't know how many were taken out. You know, I mean, possibly by the time it impacted and exploded, you possibly have hundreds of them being taken out and hundreds more damage. So at this point, you don't have all this massive amount of weight now redistributed to the other surrounding beams that are not destroyed yet. Well, guess what? That's going to cause damage. That's that redistribution of weight will cause damage. It will cause that they take on a lot more than they're meant to take on. As a matter of fact, I mean, I guess it's, I'm not going to look it up right now, but I mean, I know the facts are out there on how much those beams can actually support before they start to mess up. And you don't, these people don't seem to understand that this is a building. They have like floors and floors and floors and floors and floors of concrete and steel on top of them. Now they're taking on all that fucking weight. So that's damage number three. Now damage number four, extreme heat. Now people keep saying, oh, well, jet fuel doesn't melt steel beams. Well, that's bullshit in the sense that steel beams will be completely unaffected by a jet fuel fire. Now, the video I sent to you, Nick, is them doing an experiment where they took one steel beam, put it on top of on these support concrete with a puddle of jet fuel under it, and then they welded weights on top of the beams to mimic the amount of weight that these beams would be under supporting at the time, and then they lit the jet fuel. Now the jet fuel got the fire in that area got to about almost 2,000 degrees, because people also don't understand, like, yeah, something's burning, that's fine, but the metal can continue to absorb that heat and continue to get hot, right? Yep. So you have, on top of that, they say, oh, well, jet fuel only burns at 1,500 degrees. Yeah, jet fuel by itself, with no other factor, burns it at 1,500 degrees. The open air environment. In a closed air environment, you're looking at like triple that heat, because it's like an oven. When you turn on your oven to 400 degrees, those bars do not heat up to 400 degrees. Those bars heat up enough to make the inside of that oven 400 degrees, and it doesn't, it's not just, it's the bars and the closed air environment that creates that heat.
Yep.
That heat gets trapped in there, and then more heat is added. So when you have something like jet fuel and other materials burning and fueling this fire, you're not getting 1,500 degrees burning. You're getting 4,500 degrees burning.
Mm-hmm.
So all these beams that are left that are weakened already from being hit with the impact and the explosion, and are now have all this extra weight redistributed onto them, are now being weakened by the heat. At this point, you have all these floors with a very, very flaky support system under it. Eventually, that half is going to buckle and fall. And the one thing a lot of people don't know, a lot of people don't look into, and this is fact, is that the World Trade Center was built in a way, structural integrity of that building ever be compromised, the building is to collapse in on itself. This helps minimize casualties. See, if a building falls over, you're taking so much other shit out.
Yep.
If a building falls in on itself, is it going to cause damage? Yes. But this is the difference between blowing up a neighborhood and blowing up 10 fucking blocks.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So with that said, this is confirmed. Even the 9/11 truther documentary people confirmed this, that those buildings and a lot of really, really tall skyscrapers like that are built in a way. They are built in a way to where if the structural integrity of it is ever compromised, it is built to collapse in on itself should that ever happen. So there's your 9/11 truth for you.
Oh, yes.
And now they always keep saying the Building 7 bullshit. Building 7 was demolished. That has been officially stated. But the fucking idiots don't know that. Building 7 was set for demolition. If you look at the reports, basically Building 7 was set to be demolished, but it was supposed to be demolished like at a later date. But it was already being set up for demolition. That's why when you look at Building 7 fall, even though it looks like a controlled demolition, it looks like a sloppy one, because the whole thing wasn't set up yet for demolition. And now you have Building 7 taking on all this damage from giant pieces of a building falling through its ceiling, and then when the buildings fell and all that other stuff. So when they were able to clear everybody, there's the one dude who was in charge of that operation legitimately comes out and says, during all this chaos and after we cleared everybody, we decided to just go ahead and pull it down. Like, it's a fact that they were going to demolish that building anyway. It absolutely makes no sense for this government who creates this grand scheme to say, okay, we're going to control demolition the World Trade Center, and then we're going to control demolition Building 7 just because. No one's going to find that suspicious. They would never do that purposely, because that would create too much suspicion, as it has. And as far as if the whole thing was an inside job is what I'm saying.
All right. Thank you for your insight, my friend. And I'll have a link to this guy's YouTube channel below. This is my boy CPN. So yeah, thanks for spitting some knowledge for these 9/11 truther idiots, my friend. I really appreciate that.
Alrighty.
All right, man.